welcome to the People's Church Divine Prophecy. My name is Reverend Judy Weaver, and I'm excited and delighted to welcome you to our church. Mark, can I call on you and ask you to come up and to light the candle, symbolizing mind, body, and spirit? I think I have a little echo. Perfect. Thank you so much. We are here. Please join me in an attitude of prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you. Thank you so much for the blessings of this amazing and beautiful day. For the amazing and beautiful new child who's come to join us this day. The hearts and souls who've all chosen to be here as one, to share your love and light, and to open ourselves to all that can be and will be and is thine. We ask this in your precious name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. We will go ahead and start with our first song. Miss Marty?
We have a special request. Anytime you would like music sent out to you, remember we are the music. So our first song is going to be In the Garden. And this goes out to Debbie. Yeah. So we're going to do In the Garden. That's hymn number four.
Go ahead and move on over. What we will do during the process is we will go forward with a meditation, a healing meditation, a guided meditation that I will lead everyone in. But what we will do in the beginning is on the back of your hymnal, there is a prayer for spiritual healing, so if you please read with me.
I ask the great unseen healing force to remove all obstructions from my mind and body and to restore me to perfect health. I ask this in all sincerity and honesty, and I will do my part. I ask this great unseen healing force to become the presence of compassionate ones who are in need of help and to restore them to perfect health. I put my trust in the love and power of God.
All right. So we'll go ahead and get started. So everyone, please just sit comfortably in your chair. Feet on the floor. Put your hands in an upward position in your lap. Close your eyes. And take a deep breath. Inhale and exhale. If you'd like a healing, go right over to the chair at any time. With every inhale, you're breathing in God's love. And as you exhale, you're releasing. Releasing anything that's not the highest and the best of self. Down to the bottoms of your feet and out into our Mother Earth. Body to relax more and more. Allow your mind to quiet the chatter and for thoughts to gently float through. And allow yourself to just relax more and more with every inhale and exhale. Start with the bottoms of your feet and feel the relaxation. Up your legs and down out the bottom of your feet. Allow your whole legs and knees and thighs to be completely relaxed. Feel the relaxation through your torso and your buttocks and down again through the bottoms of your feet. Feel the relaxation across the tops of your shoulders, the front of your chest, down through your arms and hands and out through the bottoms of your feet. Feel the relaxation across your neck and up into your head and around your face and across your mind. Allow the busy thoughts that no longer need to be here at this moment just gently fade away. Your body is completely and totally relaxed. Bring your intention upward to the tops of your head. The very top of your head is your crown chakra. Feel it open as if a lotus flower unfolding. As it opens, you feel golden shower of God's love. The shiver and the warmth and just the love as it is overpowering into your body parts. It flows down. It's cool and tingling and warm and shimmering all at once, filling and healing all aspects of your mind. Connecting your right and left hemisphere. Connecting the synapses once again. Allowing anything not at the highest and the purest to just attach and to run through the bottoms of your feet.
body.
Also see the pond that you stand upon. You are one. You are one with. My child, I have called you here and welcome you within. Within the light of all beginning and end. You look above, you look below, to the left and the right, and you know this is the great light, the light of life, which is all around and within too. Yes, my child, this is a gift to you, from me to you, to know, to understand all that can be and shall be is within you. Child, why do you limit yourself from what you can do and be? Do not allow the words from others to harm thee, to hold one back from what can be. You have faith. You are faith, and this is why you are here in this space and place with me now, child. Open your heart and call. Call in what your deepest passion is. For what shall be, you want it to be. Call it within me now, child.
Back into the physical. Feel the chair below you. Feel
feel your extremities. Go ahead, feel your fingers and toes. Wiggle them, take a deep breath in. Inhale and exhale. And inhale and exhale. Acclimate yourself to the physical once again. Know the truth of the violet flame that you went to visit, and the gift from God, the great one, who spoke into reality what your dream is. Welcome back and open your eyes when you're ready. Thank you to our healers. Join me and stand as we get ourselves grounded once again. Smarty, would you like to lead us in song, please?
Let's sing Hannah's favorite. One day she said, "Why don't we ever do In the Saints?" And I was like, "Well, I don't know. Why don't we?" It's number 9. It's hymn number 9. When the saints go marching. And of course, if you feel like romping, stomping, wiggling, and talking, feel free. People's Church, give you a beat.
Oh, when the saints go marching in, oh, when the saints go marching in, I want to be in that chorus. When the saints go marching in, oh, when those bells begin to chime, oh, when the bells begin to chime, haven't you want to be in that chorus? When the bells begin to chime.
Well, now it's time to move into the second portion of our service, which is our inspirational lecture. And today we have our pastor, Reverend Steve Adkins, who is an ordained minister, medium, healer, teacher, and lecturer. He serves as the pastor of this church and has since its inception, which meets here every Sunday at 11 a.m. And we are delighted that you are in cheer. He's been a spiritual worker for more than 25 years and has worked in the UK and the USA demonstrating evidential spiritual existence and performing physical healing. And I'm sure he's going to take his gifts and talents to Indonesia. It will be very interesting to hear new techniques that you come back with. So please help me in welcoming our Reverend Steve Adkins.
Good morning again.
Good morning again.
I'd like to start my talk with reading something out of my 24 Hours a Day book. This is a book that the group that helped me get sober used a long time ago. They've written their own book since then, but this is the original one they used to use. This is the thought for today, for today. Each one of us is a child of God. Inasmuch, we are full of the promise of spiritual growth. The young person is like the springtime of the year. The full time of fruit is not yet, but there is a promise of the blossom. There is a spark of the divine in every one of us. Each has some of God's Spirit which can be developed by spiritual exercise. Such blessings can be yours, such joys, such wonders, as long as you develop in the sunshine of God's love. When I think back over my life's path, my dad was in the Air Force, and we moved almost every 6 months for about the first 10, 15 years of my life. He was a SAC test pilot for B-52s. And I was the new boy in school almost every year, every 6 months. Now, you're coming into a parochial school where these guys have been around each other since they learned how to walk. So it's quite clannish, quite club-oriented, and I was not part of the club. And on top of it, I had a sister that was a little older than me and a little younger than me, which was unending fodder for guys to make comments about him and for me to get mad and get into a fight over. So that was how my early time went moving through school. It was always a little boy, always, my dad used to tell me, he said, "I can't keep shirts on, they're too expensive." He says, "These, you know, you keep getting your shirt torn off your back every week here." And I was a small guy too. I was like 4'8", 68 pounds. I wasn't hardly big enough to do anything, but I still had a temper. And that's how I learned to deal with life coming up all the way through life. And it was kind of odd because I went from, at 14 years old, I was the youngest Eagle Scout in the state of Kansas, and I got written up in the paper for it. 2 years later, I was addicted to drugs and living in the street. So it was quite a change in a very short amount of time for me. 3 years after that, the actual headline of the paper read, "A small Vietnam erupts in East Orange County." And I had gotten myself into a position where me and the law enforcement agencies had a disagreement, I guess. And I ended up incarcerated for about 5 years. It was a lot longer of a sentence than that, but my actual time in was 5 years. During that time was my true spiritual awakening. And the first person that helped me with that was a student of Yogi Bhajan's who came into the county jail while I was waiting to be tried for my crimes. And he came in there and said that he could teach us a way to deal with drug withdrawals, because back then they didn't have methadone, they didn't have clinics, nobody really cared if you lived or died when you were withdrawing from drugs. They just threw all the drug addicts in the same cell block and hoped they didn't kill each other or die by the time they got straight. So this guy comes into this atmosphere and he says, "I can teach you a way to deal with what you're going through, but you have to do everything I tell you to do. I get you in your own cell block, I get you good food, but you have to do what I tell you to do every day." So I signed up for that. And this individual started teaching us Kundalini Yoga to control drug withdrawals. And it worked. But you had to do it every day for an hour at 5 a.m, which was quite an ordeal. And it was a very interesting walk with that. And during that time, I got a hold of a tarot deck, and I started reading tarot deck readings for other people in the lockup. And one day, the guy that was a student of Yogi Bhajan was coming there, and he says, he had me do a reading for him, and he looked at the cards, and he looked at me, and he said, "In 5 to 10 years, you're not going to need those cards anymore." And here I am doing mediumship today and doing healing. So it was kind of an interesting encounter. As I moved on through the process, as I said, I grew up in parochial schools and a Catholic. So eventually a priest came into my area of influence and sat there and counseled me and talked to me quite a bit on a weekly basis. And then I ended up in the penitentiary. In the penitentiary, it's kind of odd because I'm sitting there, and this is at Rayford. They got a transition unit up there to move out into the population where you're going to end up at. And they throw everybody that's convicted of anything in the same area. There's no separation between the murderers and the rapists and the guys in there for a bag of pot. Everybody's in the same place at the same time. And I'm sitting there on the bunk one day, and there's about 5 or 6 guys, and they're all talking about what they're in there for. This guy's in there for murder and his whole family, including his wife and kids. This guy's in there for murder and two fellow convicts, and back from being tried and resentenced for it. This guy over here is for a bag of pot. And it's just, and there's nothing between you and these kind of people but opportunity and air. Nothing at all there. There are guards there, but there's one for about every 100 inmates. There's not much there other than to clean up the debris after a fight. They don't really stop anything. And into this, I started practicing that discipline of Kundalini Yoga, the breathing, the exercises, controlling my emotions just like I learned to control the drug withdrawals. that was really instrumental and helpful to me, because like I said, it was a pretty severe atmosphere. Not only are you in there with those type of people, but those type of people prey on the less able to defend themselves. They prey on them physically, they prey on them mentally. And this one guy came in there, he was from a well-off family in there for selling pot. And he got taken in by a clan of guys, and they palled around with him, made him think he was somebody. And when he got ready to be released, now everybody in there knows when you're going to get released. 90 days before you're released, it's not this thing where they knock on your cell, it's a, hey, you're getting out today. You know, 90 days before you're going, and the entire population knows that. And they know you can't get in a fight or you'll lose your date. They know you can't do anything. You're going to lose that date to get out. And that means something to some people, and it doesn't mean something to others, because the reality is you have to deal with what's in front of you, not what's going to happen down the road. So they convinced this guy to do something that ended up getting him killed, because he was getting ready to get released. They had a calculated risk of him getting killed or getting rid of somebody in the dormitory. They didn't want in there. And the guy they were trying to get rid of was part of the people that slaughtered this guy and his family. It was Malcolm X. He was in there for slaughtering the Malcolm X family, one of the people that did that. And they wanted to get him out of the dormitory and the cell block wing, because the guy was a rebel rouser. He didn't like white people. So they convinced this guy to do something, and he ended up getting stabbed to death 2 weeks before he left. And his parting comment when they laid him on a stretcher was, all over a $10 radio. That was his parting word for this world. This is the class of people that are in there that have absolutely no moral, ethical conduct of anything other than succeeding at what they want. And my father used to tell me, you know, there's a lot of bad people out there in that world, and I used to think he was joking. But I was right in there with it for a number of years. And I managed to survive with my sanity intact and my health intact, because I was pretty tough. I wasn't as tough as the toughest in there, but I was tough enough to make them leave me alone. It wasn't worth the trouble to bother me too much, so they ended up leaving me alone most of the time. But I did see a lot of extreme inhumanity of man to man in there. It was unbelievable. That was definitely a wake-up call for me. When I finally was released, during the time I was in there, my father died in a car train accident in Naples, Florida. My sister got OD'd at drugs at 21 years old. I come from a family of six, and that was my sister that was closest to me. And I got brought home from the prison in handcuffs for both the funerals under escort. I had to pay for the escort. But I got to go home. So it was quite an event. And again, the discipline of the Kundalini Yoga, the meditation, and that is what kept me going through that. As soon as I got out, I laid that all aside and started drinking like the Dickens. And that went on for a couple of years. Actually about 10 years, until I ended up in a conflict one night and was going home to get a shotgun and go back to evening school. And I go home, and this is where divine intervention occurs. This is 1 a.m, everybody that had a drop of blood in common with me within 50 miles was in my living room at 1 a.m, discussing what they were going to do about me before I ended up back in lockup again. And that night, I got forcibly moved to a detox center, and I had a spiritual awakening in the detox center. And it only was about a 60-second spiritual awakening of peace and calm in my life that I hadn't known since I was about 14 years old. And it was through the principles of the recovery group that I was in that happened to me. And I began seeking that peace in my life again, day by day. First it was hours at a time, then it was days at a time, then it got to be weeks at a time. And that's how I've managed to make it to where I am now. is practicing these disciplines. And during this walk, I ended up in a spiritualist church one day. It was out in Casadega. And I'm sitting there listening to the lecture, and it sounded just like a meeting of the group that I was trying to stay sober with. It sounded like the same principles, the same philosophy, the same approach to life. So I started studying the religion of spiritualism and its principles and philosophies. And today I know for a fact, even though back then I looked at it as punishment for wrongdoing, you create your own future. You create your own fate. You are the architect of your life. Now, there are certain things that the spirit realm puts there that are indispensable to your spiritual growth that might not be of your own choosing or by your own design. But there are those things that you have to deal with to make a step forward in the spiritual growth process. As I move through this process, even today, I've had numerous physical injuries over the years between, most of my stuff is self-inflicted. I don't have any hereditary illnesses or anything. It's all been self-inflicted. Going too fast, going too far, jumping too high, that kind of stuff. But with that, as I've gotten older, I'm beginning to feel all of those things every morning when I get up. And the way that I get by that is to think about the good in things, like I said in my thought for the day. The good in the things, not the difficult things, not the things that aren't going right. As my chronological age progresses, more and more people that I know are passing away. People that I knew from way back when I used to be a pure hedonist and hellraiser, they're passing away. Or they've lost their sanity. They don't have a mind left to deal with the world with. They're still caught in drug addiction or alcoholism from way back then. And I look at that and I think how fortunate I was to have the people come into my life, to have the love of my family there when I needed it, to have the love of my fellow man, the complete strangers that took time to talk to me in the group that was trying to get me, that helped me to get sober, and the spiritual inspiration. That spiritual inspiration is always there. It's never, you're never without it. It's always there. It's just our state of mind keeps us from being aware of it, of recognizing it and acting on it. In the beginning, we're not too far out of the jungle when we start down this path of spiritual awakening. We're still driven by emotion. We're still driven by anger and fear, driven by what ifs. What if this happens? What if that happens? Instead of going at it with what can I make happen? What do I have control over? And that's the path to freedom. What do I have control over? What are my choices here to make things better? It's not always necessary to put on the boxing gloves and step into a ring and fight something. Sometimes you can just step by it. You don't have to engage some things. And that might sound easier than it is, but sometimes it's pretty difficult to step by a situation, especially if it's somebody you care about. In my early days, it was if I had a chance to get even with somebody. I had a hard time stepping by that, but I don't have trouble with that anymore. Because I don't keep score anymore. I don't remember wrongs that are done to me. I remember if I can trust somebody or not, and that's how I deal with it. I don't try to get even, I don't try to get back, I don't try to prove to them that they're right or wrong. I just know how to deal with them in my own area of expertise. I don't feel bad at all about the drugging and the drinking. I enjoyed the heck out of it. I loved it when I did it. And did it to the hilt. Have no regrets about it. But it won't get me where I want to go today. I know what that life has to offer. I know the limits of that life. I know everything that life has to offer. And it won't get me where I want to go today. So if I ever engage in that type of lifestyle again, I better understand that's all I want to have. But today, I haven't had a drug or a drink since I was 35. And it's been a growing experience every day. Every day, I'm faced with choices. Every day, my mind wants to play games and decide that things aren't quite going the way they should. A little frustrations to try to get plugged in there to have a wreak havoc of my sanity and peace of mind. That's the challenge. Controlling the mind so it doesn't create worry, so it doesn't create what ifs. Deal with the love in front of you. Deal with the connection with spirit. And the best thing to do when you find yourself in difficult, almost overwhelming circumstances, if it's not a threat to your life immediately, of course, you stop, relax your mind, relax your breath, and try to bring in the presence of the higher minded that you are, or the higher mindedness of God. Take time to stop and just breathe and relax. Put a short circuit in that emotion that's trying to crank up and take over. And I know we've all had an instantaneous layup of anger, instantaneous reaction of fear overwhelming us. If we don't put a check on it, it's all that we think about. It's all that rules us for that time. We do have the option, though, to take that time knowing that the Spirit is there, knowing that our Spirit is there to tap into, to put a pause in everything. And sometimes that's all it takes is just a pause. It's not going to make the world right. It's not going to make everything rosy, but it will stop you from falling down that hole. It will stop you from escalating things to where they don't need to be. And sometimes that's all it takes is to be stopped for a moment. A chance to reconsider. A chance to let God come into your life for a moment. There are those people, though, that can't believe that you're who you say you are. And they pick at you every time they see you. They have something to say, some little challenge to toss out there, to try to see if you're who you say you are. And it's kind of funny because over the years of construction that I've been in, I've run into some people that were from my earlier life, back when I was a pretty wild person. They used to cross the street so they didn't have to meet me or talk to me. There was one guy I remember that he was in the crowd we used to run around with, a group, gang, whatever you want to call it. And he had married one of the girls in the group, and they had moved off. And she had been found in a rock quarry with her head blown off one day at lunchtime. And we were all pretty close, all of us. And I was kind of looked at like the enforcer of the group. So this is 20 years later. I'd gotten out of lock, out of prison. And I found where this guy was, and he was a pastor of a church. So I called him up, and I said, "Hey, man, how you been doing?" I said, "I know we get together and talk." He said, "Oh, everything's good." 2 days later, I tried to call him back. He changed his phone number, had left the church that he was pastoring, and completely disappeared from the face of the earth because he thought I was the person that I was all that time ago. He was afraid that I was going to do something to him for what happened to that girl. But it wasn't him that did it. She had been working at an insurance agency, and apparently it was some kind of money laundering operation. And she might have found out something because her boss took her out for lunch one day, and she ended up in a rock quarry with her head shot off. But he was afraid of me and who I was from that time. That guy's running from something that doesn't exist, that's not there anymore. And that's the things that we have to remember. Everything changes. We don't have to run for things from 20 or 30 years ago. We don't have to shy away from them anymore because we're a different person than we were back then. We've grown spiritually. We've grown with our peace of the world around us. and the worst person in the world that we have the worst time with, we can walk right up to now and be at peace with. We don't have to feel challenged. We don't have to re-engage in that old way. So I guess part of it is not being afraid of the past or anything from the past. And the other part is not being bound by what other people think you are. Not being bound by what other people think you should be. Allow yourself to be more. Allow yourself to be what God wants you to be. As I said, I retired in February. Here's this engineering firm. I don't have anything but a GED. And they're sending me over there for the kind of job they're sending me over there for. They're based on my life's experience. They looked at my life's experience, not the academics. And that's what we have to look at in our spiritual life, is our experiences, the things we've accomplished, the things we've stepped by in life, the things that we're trying to accomplish. And it's all done with the power of God, our power, the power of our spirit, and the power of the people that come into our lives, whether known or unknown to us, on a daily basis. All of these things are the tools that are for us to succeed with. Only our mind will convince us to fail. You're limited by what you think you are, what you think you aren't. Not by God, not by opportunity, and not by your spirit. So think the best for yourself. Think the most for yourself. And greater things than you can imagine or think of will be revealed to you. Because when you open that energy to things coming to you, things coming to you unknown to you, or things coming to you that are greater than what you have, it starts an energy flow from the creative spirit to you. It brings people and places and things. Now, it doesn't mean that you're going to suddenly hit the lottery and have millions of dollars. What it means is you will have opportunities to choose to succeed. You'll have opportunities to take the right steps. You'll have opportunities presented by the creative spirit to succeed and to move beyond that which you are now, personally and professionally. As I move through this life, I can look back and I see that I've got 3 children, ranging from 34 to 43, all successful to a greater or lesser degree. I've got 7 grandkids, and I've moved through a number of people's lives with my readings and healings over the years. Every so often I get a call from somebody that reminds me of something I did years ago that I didn't remember doing. It's very rewarding to know that I've managed to help somebody up and then again, either by talking or by doing healings. Don't look at your life as an accumulation of certificates on the wall. Don't look at your profession, if it's healing, reading, or being a professional, by how many people you are overseeing, or how many people that you work with. Each person that you help is as important as any number of people. Each person that you take time to have a kind word for, in a line at a supermarket, on the phone if they call you. Each person you take time to help with, you're lifting up, and is as important as anything, any other person on the face of the earth. From the president, all the way down to the homeless person in the street. Each person's soul is as important as the other in the scheme of things with God. So I ask you to think of these things and know that there is opportunity every day of your life for God to step into, for you to move a little bit beyond what you are now, become a little more than what you are now in the spiritual design of things. And the eternal design of things that's there for you, rather than the immediacies of now. Sometimes that's the difficult part of recognizing spirit, when they give you that inspiration. They give you the inspiration, and their plan is for the eternal you, not the immediate you. Sometimes their inspiration doesn't solve the immediate problem that you want to help for. But it is given to you of an eternal plan, and that's what you have to approach it as. So I ask you to think of these things. Be kind to yourself during this life's path. God loves you. You should love yourself as much. Be forgiving of yourself. Every day is a new day to start anew again. There are no lost opportunities. There is no missed chances. Just love yourself and take opportunity with those that come next. Amen.